you've got tough questions, this is a place where they aren't only welcome, but encouraged. Bring your skepticism, bring your doubts, bring all that you have, and we'll offer you the reason and evidence that you crave. Doubter, you're welcome in this place.
Does that answer your question?
I know. You've been to church, right? So let me answer some of your initial concerns and questions. First of all, we're not a cult. We are not here either to shoehorn you into a timeshare or to try to get you to buy used cars. What we are is a marvelously weird, humorous, and eclectic mix of people who've decided to follow Jesus Christ. This common pursuit, it binds us as close as family. And this is a family that's always got room for a few more people.
I don't care who you are.
If you're looking for a place to navigate the big questions of life, you're welcome.
Strong home. Welcome, or should I say, top of the morning to you, CFLM fan. Okay, that's the best I got, y'all.
Anybody have a good Irish accent or just happy?
I obviously do not. But we are glad you are here with us, especially if you're visiting this morning. We're glad you're here.
And if you have been visiting with us for a little while and you're not plugged in, you might want to talk to Ben Walker in the back and Sean. He's preaching today, so he's not here. no, I'm joking. He's here. He is somewhere. He better be here because I'm not preaching. Ben, you got one on your side pocket ready to go. But anyway, that being said, okay, I digress. So if you have been visiting with us and you want to know how to plug in and get plugged in with the congregation, see what CFLM is all about, see Ben, see Sean, we have a class 101, so we can plug you in, and I am stammering and stuttering all over, so
I bet I could pass that one. 101, I could pass that. So on Wednesday, March 27th, the Kingdom Kid Wednesday nights, everyone is invited to this Seder meal. So it's not just the kids, it's everybody. Mm-hmm. We just need you to sign up in the back if you're coming so we know how much food to make. So online or on the iPads.
Exactly. And we are going to have our first ever Good Friday Walk. A lot of you may not know what a Good Friday Walk is. And basically, it's just a time when you can come in, go through various stations, and remember the different events that led Jesus to the cross and his resurrection. So it kind of really focuses you in on his sacrifice. We have some flyers in the back, so grab one, take one, put it on the refrigerator so you remember it, but also grab another one so that you can give to a neighbor, a friend, or somebody who you think would like, need to be invited to CFLM. This is a great opportunity for the come in, low stress, you know, not anything, but you can come in at any point. There's Sean, right there. Yeah, so if you...
He made it.
He made it. So come anywhere between 2 and 6, and you kind of go through the stations at your own pace.
Building update.
We practiced really hard for that one.
So this week, the baptistry was delivered.
Yay! Good job.
We had quite a few strong young men with strong backs that brought it into the building for us. So
yes.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
And all those, also this week, the electrical and HVAC, the work is continued. And $2,900 was given to the building fund this last week. So I think George will be able to write some checks.
Yeah, he has bigger numbers to fill, but plugging away. Let's go ahead and stand up and continue our worship. How desperate are you for the Lord? To what lengths are you willing to go to get close to him? There is a Bible story in Luke that talks about a paralyzed man, and he had great friends who wanted to get this man to see Jesus for healing. And these guys, they came, they took this man, their friend, to Jesus, but he was surrounded because he was teaching. So he was surrounded by people, and they could not get to them. And you know the story. They went to the roof, and they tore the roof off. How desperate are you for Jesus? How hard are you willing to work to get to him? Are you willing to tear down the roof, break down the walls, get a little uncomfortable? Let's take a moment. We're just going to pray silently to our Lord. Have him reveal what is blocking our communication with him. Lord, you are our assistant.
Said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never be hungry, He who puts his trust in me will never be thirsty.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me.
This is my daily bread. Water for my thirsty soul, I need you. Oh,
So Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in yourselves."
Reminds us of what allows us to approach your throne. your broken, tortured body, the blood pouring out from your head, your side, your hands, your feet. It wasn't the nails that held you there, and we acknowledge that. Lord, it was your love for us. And we praise you, and we remember this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
And I saw between the throne with the four living creatures and the elders a lamb standing as if slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God, sent out to all the earth. And he came and took the book out of the right hand of him who sat on the throne. When we had taken the book, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell face down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and a golden bowl full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, "Worthy are you to take the book and break its seals, for you were slain, and purchased for God with your blood men from every tribe and every tongue and every people and every nation. You have made them a kingdom of priests to our God, and they will reign upon the earth." Revelation 5:6-10. Depictions of our crucified Messiah will always bring me to tears, glorified on the throne of God, knowing that we put him on the cross, and that he willingly went through that for our sakes. It will always bring me to tears, as well it should. I dread the day that I fail to recognize its significance. Likewise, we do well recognize the significance of communion. Do this in remembrance of me. So, as we continue in worship, and as you take your communion, dwell upon the Lamb of God, who takes away our sin. Let us pray. God our Father, praise be to you forever and ever for your incredible sacrifice. Praise be forever to your name for undergoing torment that we might be called your children. We eagerly await your return. Amen. You may now partake.
Good morning. Yeah, Rachel called me out for being late to the service. I apologize. If that ever happens to you, just tell them you got Steved. Do not specify a Steve. Those who have ears to hear will hear. Meanwhile, little ones, you are dismissed. Feel free to head out the back. The rest of you, go ahead and be prepared to recite the memory verse. So go ahead and share with your spouse, with your neighbor. If you are new here, do not feel like you should have this memorized yet. Instead, listen along and see if this is the kind of church you want to attend. And so go ahead and go. Excellent. Excellent. First service, there's a little bit more people, and they did just as well, but it's in like 30 different speeds. That was very on pace. Thank you. So before I get into the message, I did just want to take a moment and express some words of thanks and gratitude. If you're unaware, my mother-in-law, Kristen's mom, passed away a couple weeks ago, and the amount of love and support from the church has really been incredible. We are just so very grateful for that. For instance, at the funeral service a couple weeks ago, it became standing room only, and several of our family members came up and said, if we lived closer, this would be our home church. We would like to be here. This is an incredible group of people. And so I just wanted to express my thanks that they were able to see, you know, God's hands and feet, his people on display. So thank you. Now, speaking of my wife, a few years ago, she came home with this implement of death, and I didn't know what I'd done wrong, but I knew I was about to find out. And so I really had no idea what this was. It just looked like a medieval torture device, and I had no idea why it had come to have a place in my home. Now, many of you who are adept at gardening know that this is the tiller that you leave on the ground when you've decided it's time to go rent one that runs on gas. And so I have come to learn that as well. The dirt on here, very old. Very old. It does not get a lot of experience. But I bring that up because as we're talking about spiritual disciplines, it's very helpful to think about gardens and tools. Gardens and tools. And so in the case of spiritual disciplines, the garden is you. The garden is your life. And so there are sources of death and corruption, weeds and pests that we need to remove, but there's also sources of life. If you look at a healthy, thriving garden, there's aspects worthy of praise, worthy of celebration. That's generally true in believers as well. Sometimes that's overlooked, but I think it's important to pause and praise God for those moments. But there's also those seeds. Those are things of potential, those things that aren't quite growing yet, but we're hopeful that they will. And so if you are the garden, then the disciplines are the tools, like the tiller. Now, here the metaphor breaks down a little bit because prayer, as we talked about, is less of a tool than it's the water used to sustain the garden, but you get the idea. The disciplines are the tools and the means that God has given us to be faithful stewards of the garden of our lives. And so if God's will for us is to become conformed to the image of his Son, and it is, Romans 8:29 makes that clear, then the disciplines are the practices of Jesus himself. He is the teacher, he is the rabbi, and we are the students who are kind of fumbling about trying to figure out which tool to use and when. And so thinking about the disciplines as tools is helpful because you have to have the right tool for the right job. Now, years ago, I learned that the house behind mine was a meth house. Now, I learned that how anyone else would learn that during a Bible study. And so there I was, out on my back deck, just having a Bible study around a fire, talking about, ancient Near Eastern history, of all things. And as we're talking about that, suddenly I hear, get down, hands up, and I hear all this screaming. And we're just sitting there, and we look over, and there is police raiding this home. And so I come to talk to the officers because, you know, later they're out and about looking for things in the 3-foot-tall grass. And so then the owner comes and I start to talk to him a little bit. And well, one of the first tasks of the owner is to cut down this 3-foot-tall grass. And so they do. And then I look out the next day, and there's these men out there with shovels just trying to scrape the grass into piles. And I felt so bad. And so with pity in my heart, I went out to my barn. I grabbed every rake I had. I came, stood at the perimeter of their yard, and held it up as a wave offering. And so I stood there and just like, you want these? You want these? And so we didn't really speak the same language, but the joy on their face told me they absolutely did. And so an hour later, they were done. Right tool, right job. It's very important. It's very important. And so as we consider the discipline of fasting, I liken it to this tiller here because it pierces, right? You know, this is violent. It disrupts. It breaks up soil. It breaks up that which was hard and compact within our hearts. But it doesn't do that to destroy. It ultimately does that to prepare. It does that to prepare. And so in doing that, it's preparing the ground for something new, something growing, something good and fruitful. And so let's go ahead and pray as we turn our attention to this often dreaded tool. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity to come together. Lord, we thank you for this group of believers, this wonderful, wonderful group of people whom you love, whom you've died for, and we pray that we would love one another as you've called us to do so. Father, we thank you for your word and the opportunity to hear it. We thank you for the opportunity to sing your praises and worship you, for only you deserve all the glory, honor, and praise. And Father, we thank you that we can have these times to remember your suffering, the suffering of your son, Jesus, on our behalf. And so as we gather, as we read your word, let it be to your glory. It's in your son's holy and precious name we pray. Amen. All right, so to think through fasting, we're going to begin with objections and the reality that no food is no fun. Then we're going to turn our attention to fasting, focus, and freedom. And then we shall talk about getting started. And so I've taught on the spiritual disciplines on multiple occasions over my 13 years of ministry. And when I do, I usually begin by giving an assessment, a test of sorts. And what I do is I give the students a list, much like the list on the screen, much like the list in the book that you may be reading along, Celebration of Discipline. And what I ask them to do is rank them 1 through 12. And I don't say rank them based on what you think you should be doing. It's rank them based on what you're actually doing. I think it's a helpful self-reflection, and this can kind of change throughout the course of your life. And that's fine. It's helpful to analyze these things. And having done this on multiple occasions, there's a few trends that have emerged over the years. Trend number one is that prayer, scripture study, and worship are always at the top. They're always some combination of the top three every single time. Another trend that has emerged is that silence and solitude are always higher than I would expect. And that's pretty surprising because I don't know about you. When I think about teenagers, I do not associate them with silence and solitude. It doesn't come naturally. I have three teenage boys, not quiet. And so it doesn't seem, but nevertheless, I find that very encouraging because what that tells me is that teens stuck in this noisy, crazy world thirst to get away. They thirst for quiet. They thirst to be with the Lord. The third trend that always is the case is that fasting is last. And it's last by a comical margin. Because what I'll do is I'll write it down on a whiteboard. We'll total up the numbers, put it up there. And it's like, you know, oh, these are pretty close. Fasting. Nobody wants to do it. Most haven't even done it. And so that's become very common. And so when you frequently talk to people about their relationship with God, there's some convictions that naturally rise to the surface. And I know Ben knows this just as well. You know, if someone learns I'm a pastor, they may say something like, oh, I know I should go to church more. I didn't ask, but I hope that you would. That would be fantastic. I was just sharing my name and my occupation. It's great to meet you. Other comments come up like, I wish I had a better prayer life, or I need to get back into the Word. These comments often come up even though I'm not really trying to elicit these confessions. It's ingrained within believers that prayer and reading the Word and gathering with other believers should be a priority, even if it's not. But you know what I've never heard anyone say? Man, I just need a fast. I have never seen anyone get up and look at a beautiful day and say, you know, we've had rain and terrible gray skies for the last month, but today is a great day not to eat. Never seen it. I haven't. And I never will. I really don't expect to. And so I think it's an interesting that nevertheless, Jesus expected his disciples would fast, right? And so go ahead and turn to Matthew chapter 6, verses 16 through 18. We're going to be in several passages today, but the two main ones are going to be in Matthew 6 as well as Luke 5, just for your own preparation. So we'll start off in Matthew 6, 16 through 18, in which we see Jesus says, "Whenever you fast, do not put on a gloomy face as the hypocrites do, for they neglect their appearance so that they will be noticed by men when they are fasting. Truly, I say to you, they have their reward in full. But you, when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face so that your fasting will not be noticed by men, but by your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you." And so I want to encourage you to start by underlining the phrase "whenever you fast" in verse 16, as well as "when you fast" in verse 17. You know, Jesus in his great mercy did not make fasting an explicit command. This makes fasting qualitatively different from some of the other disciplines. After all, as Ben shared with us last week, when it comes to prayer, we are to pray without ceasing. Yes, never stop. But you're never going to find a verse that says fast without ceasing. And all God's people said, that's right. And so we see it's a bit different. But we need to kind of consider, why is it, if fasting is so beneficial for us, wouldn't God command it? Why wouldn't he? Well, I think in part, God in his great wisdom knows that there's cases where abstaining from food would in fact harm people. And so God in his grace and his wisdom did not explicitly command this to perhaps protect those who couldn't actually do it. And so in thinking about fasting, a helpful way to consider it might be to think of it as a meal with a spouse or a friend. Now I know comparing fasting to eating is a bit of a stretch, but hear me out. In some cases, the meal is rather simple or common. You know, you sit down at the dinner table, you have a meal that you've had 1,000 times before, sitting with your family. It's not a special occasion. It's like pulled pork at my house. We eat it all the time. On other occasions, it may be appropriate for you to go out on a date or to go to somewhere else where the circumstances, the surroundings have changed. You free yourself from the distractions and you're really able to focus and talk about something that perhaps you've been putting off, or perhaps it's you just need a new situation, a new scenario to share these things. Well, I would compare prayer to the meal and fasting to the circumstances. Because ultimately it's prayer, it's the conversation with God that sustains us, that builds us up, that feeds us. But sometimes we need to change the circumstances a little bit. And so when it comes to fasting, that helps us to change up the circumstances so that we can focus a bit more intently than we had been previously. Now, returning to Jesus' words in Matthew 6, just consider for a moment how different our world is from their world. After all, if you saw someone looking gloomy or tired or ill, you might assume many things. You know, after all, today is St. Patrick's Day, where so many are wearing green. If many people came in here today looking a little gloomy, what would you think? You probably wouldn't think very strongly of that. Or, you know, given people looking tired, we have like 732 children in this church. And so if a young mom or young father look really tired, we may assume, well, child is screaming all night. Or we might see somebody looking gloomy and think they just ate too much El Picante. But in no world are you going to see somebody who looks gloomy in this church and think, hey man, your fasting is showing. That's never going to happen. You're never going to see somebody looking dreary and be concerned that perhaps they're in day 32 of a fast. You're not going to get there. And so in thinking about all that, we just have to see how different our world is from theirs, because in their world, it's been observed that in Jesus' day, some religious leaders would fast on Mondays and Thursdays, knowing that those were market days and that they would be seen and praised, and they received their reward in full. And so fasting has become kind of trendy in the last couple years as a dieting fad. So here's as good a place as any to define biblical fasting. There are many fasts, and many of them are good and beneficial, but many are distinct from the fasting we see in Scripture. For instance, I compare it to this. Suppose there has been an uprising in the youth room, and the youth are all very upset with the quality of the chairs. And so very upset with the quality of the chairs, they put together a chant, as rebellious people do. And putting together a chant, they say, "New chairs for our derrieres." And they just keep chanting this, wanting a new seat. And they say, "We are not going to eat until you give us a new seat." And they make it very, very clear. They have all their rhymes in place. And we quickly remind them they are not getting new chairs until this building is done. And so, nevertheless, we have to ask ourselves, is the hunger strike truly fasting, right? And we hear that and we're like, well, kind of. On the one hand, fasting is quite literally just abstaining from food. And so we see this even in the first meal of the day, breakfast, breaking the fast from the previous evening. And so strictly speaking, fasting is just not eating food. But we would also say that when it comes to the hunger fast, it's not necessarily a Christian fast. It's not done for spiritual discipline. It's using the tool of fasting as leverage, as persuasion, perhaps even as manipulation, rather than to develop a greater love for the Lord. And so in this case, the hunger fast kind of becomes a way of using the fast for earthly rewards, not heavenly ones. But wait, what about social media fasts or abstaining from something other than food? We are, after all, in the Lenten season. And though we don't really communally practice Lent as a congregation, I know many do individually, abstaining from a particular food or pleasure. And so, abstaining from these kind of things, from pleasure, from gratification, from entertainment, from social media and all this, these can be wise and beneficial. You can learn a lot of self-control and good things doing these kinds of fasts. In fact, if not eating food or if biblical fasting in that way isn't something you can personally do for dietary or medical issues, these are great alternatives to consider. But it's worth pointing out that in Jesus' day, this isn't the kind of fast that he had in mind. When Jesus said fast, he wasn't telling his disciples to, you know, stop scrolling Facebook. And so a key difference is that human beings were not created to live off the fuel of Facebook or Instagram or video games or any other form of leisure. Entire civilizations have come and gone without those things. And yet humans were created to live off of food. Eating food is essential to living. It's essential to life. It's part of what makes us human. And so denying ourselves food is a way in which we engage in how God designed us. But more on that momentarily. And so fasting then is abstaining from food to focus on the Lord and to be freed from distraction or the grip of instant gratification and other temptations. When it comes to my observation of fasting throughout Scripture, I kind of see those three F's on display. There's fasting, focus, and freedom. Fasting, focus, and freedom. And when we look at some of the texts, we're going to pull that out. But first, let's return to the passage we just read. You can kind of see why Jesus would instruct his disciples to fast in secret. Because if fasting is abstaining from food to be freed from worldly distractions so we can better focus on God, then we must do our best to avoid these opportunities to be praised by others. Because we're the kind of people who just love to be seen and love to be applauded when we do something incredible. For example, at the end of my street, I live in a cul-de-sac. Got a basketball hoop, and I enjoy taking many a trick shot. I do not make many a trick shot, but I take many a trick shot. And on the rare occasion that I make one, my natural response is, you know, look around. Did anybody see that? That was incredible. No one did. And that's usually how it is. You know, how often when something incredible happens, do we want to be noticed and yet there's no one there to give us praise? And so it's very important to intentionally resist that kind of praise that comes from other people. Now, this might be an unnecessary clarification, but this doesn't mean that it's always wrong to tell somebody else that you're fasting. There might, in fact, be circumstances where that's wise and good. For example, say that you decide, you know, tomorrow's the day. I'm convicted from that sermon. So I am going to fast tomorrow. And in doing so, you don't inform your spouse who is cooking dinner. Well, you have just created unnecessary conflict in your home. You're going to have fights. You're going to have problems. They're going to be very upset. They've done all this hard work, and there you are just staring at them eat. And so don't do that. Communicate with the people in your home what it is you are doing. Because the point is not total secrecy. The point is fasting in such a way that you're not seeking praise and admiration from others. And so we don't need to tell everyone. And it's wise to keep it to a minimum, but sometimes somebody may need to know. For example, a few years ago, a friend of mine was telling me how deeply frustrated he was that no matter how much he tried battling with lust and fighting against it, he just kept failing. He was so upset and so angry. And I told him, I was like, hey, man, well, tomorrow I'll fast and pray for you with this. And so he was just caught off guard and very thankful. And he's one who, due to various issues, can't really fast due to some dietary stuff. And so I think he was deeply appreciative. And I wanted him to know that so that every time he'd be fighting with that, he would know there was someone interceding on his behalf, crying out to the Lord every time he struggled with that. And so there's a wisdom to these things. We don't need to broadcast it to the world, but there may be some wisdom in telling a select few depending on what's going on in your life. Now, if fasting is expected but not commanded, then we have to recognize that we Pharisees really are quick to find some wiggle room to play with that and to justify why we don't want to do it. Because if it's not commanded, we're going to find all kind of reasons. For example, you know, a new restaurant opened up. I want to support my local economy. Or perhaps my spouse is an amazing cook, and I just want to bless how God has gifted her. Or you might make up other excuses such as you'll be uncomfortable or dizzy or irritable, and it's just not right to go through the work week like that. But in moments of real honesty, we really like food, and we don't really like denying ourselves anything at all. And so we have a multitude of objections to fasting, but during Jesus' ministry, the Pharisees and scribes didn't criticize Jesus' fasting, they criticized his feasting. And so turning now to Luke 5, we see a whole bunch of criticisms and objections because Jesus and his disciples were eating and drinking with sinners and tax collectors. Meanwhile, the Pharisees and the disciples of John, they routinely fasted, and yet Jesus always seemed to be eating and drinking, a glutton and a drunkard, they would call him. And so let's look at how Jesus responds to their objections. Luke chapter 5, verses 33 to 35. And they said to him, "The disciples of John often fast and offer prayers. The disciples of the Pharisees also do the same. But yours eat and drink." And Jesus said to them, "You cannot make the attendants of the bridegroom fast while the bridegroom is with them, can you? But the days will come and when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and they will fast in those days." And so the implied objection of the Pharisees and scribes is that spiritual people, people who are serious about their faith, people who take God seriously, those are the people who fast. And so Jesus, meanwhile, fed thousands on a couple occasions. He even turned water into wine long after much wine had already been served. His earthly ministry was one of feasting and celebration, not fasting. At least that's what they saw, because the fasting he had been done in secret. And so Jesus' lack of piety exposed him and condemned him in the eyes of religious leaders. Their piety meant they were more qualified to teach than God. And so we often have the same objection as the Pharisees, but instead of using it to disqualify Jesus, we use it to disqualify ourselves. We use it to explain why we don't fast, because after all, fasting is for the super spiritual. That's for those who are in leadership. That's for others. How can I be expected to fast when I'm just getting by in my faith, when I'm just running on fumes? And so if you're struggling with everything else in your relationship with the Lord, how can you be expected to do this? Now, what did Jesus say when challenged? He said, "But the days will come, and when the bridegroom," and who's the bridegroom? Jesus. Jesus is the bridegroom. When that happens, when he is taken away from them, they will fast in those days. And so who were the they that Jesus was referring to? It was the disciples. He was talking to the disciples. The same sick, desperate, confused, and sinful men that Jesus had just been feasting with. And Jesus' expectation wasn't then that fasting was for the religious elite or for those in authority. Rather, his expectation was that those who knew their lives were messed up and broken would come to him in utter dependence and seek him out in this way. And so if you're tempted to reject fasting on the grounds that you're barely getting by, your very words prove that you're the exact kind of person Jesus had in mind when he talked about fasting. And so perhaps at this point you're thinking, well, all right, maybe that's the case, but fasting would seem to go against our very nature, against our very design as people who run on food for fuel. It's likely to compromise my ability at work. It would get in the way of exercise. It's contrary to nearly everything I've heard growing up and the food pyramids I've seen. Now, this is an unintentionally multi-layered objection, because I think it's how most people think. It's Trinitarian. There are three objections in one. And so the three objections are, we weren't designed to do this. Secondly, it would get in the way of my work. And thirdly, this goes against everything I've learned. Three objections. And so rather than think of ourselves as people who run exclusively on gas, it would be more accurate to think of ourselves as hybrid cars. Now, I know this congregation well enough to know some are like, I don't love this illustration. Bear with me. And so, simply put, we were designed by God to be metabolically flexible. What that means is at times we run on sugar, at other times we run on fat. And we can't really run on both at the same time. But we were designed by God to run on each as needed. And so many Americans run almost exclusively on sugar, which is one of the reasons we have such a hard time losing weight. It's one of the reasons we are always hungry. And so Dr. Jason Fung puts it this way. Let's imagine that we are living in Paleolithic times. During the summer of plenty, we eat lots of food and store some of that fat on our body. Now it's winter, and there is nothing to eat. What do you suppose our body does? Should we start burning our precious muscle while preserving our stored food, fat? Doesn't that sound pretty idiotic? It's as if you store firewood for a wood-burning oven, you pack lots of firewood away in your storage unit. In fact, you have so much, it's spilling over your house and you don't even have enough room for all the wood you've stored. It's a pretty personal attack. But when the time comes to start up the oven, you immediately chop up your sofa and throw it into the oven. Pretty stupid, right? Why would we assume our body is also so stupid? The logical thing to do is start burning the stored wood. In the case of the body, we start to burn the stored food, fat stores, instead of burning precious muscle. And so when we engage our bodies in this way, shifting back and forth from sugar to fat, we're engaging with the way we were designed. And fasting helps us do that. And so fasting helps our bodies go back and forth and to ultimately reflect the way that God created us to work. Now, if all of that sounds silly to you, here's another way to think about it. If God expects us to fast, then doesn't it seem reasonable that he would design us in such a way that we can fast and that we can fast in such a way that though it may be difficult, it's not absolutely torturous? We were designed for this. Fasting for most people does not compromise our ability to work, exercise, or be productive. I'll say more on that in a moment, but first, a word about our food pyramids and the talking heads who tell us that it's better to eat a loaf of bread with a cup of milk extracted from an almond than a chicken thigh with a cup of milk from a cow. Jay Richards, research assistant professor in the Bush School of Business at the Catholic University of America, and formerly a fitness trainer, wrote an excellent book on fasting entitled Eat Fast Feast that I think I've probably gotten like 10 to 15 people in this church to read at this point. And throughout the book, he highlights the many failures of modern education regarding food and nutrition. Those with the biggest piece of the pyramid also conveniently fund the pyramid and its place in education. Contradictions in headlines over the last several decades should alert us to the fact that something is wrong. Richards writes, If you have read diet advice headlines for the last 30 years, you may have noticed that the conventional wisdom on fats kept changing. One day, we were told that eggs are bad for you since they are filled with cholesterol. The next day, we were told that eggs are good for you. For years, we were told, dump butter and eat margarine and industrial seed oils instead. Then, we found out that trans fats and margarine and Crisco are much worse than the butter and lard they were supposed to replace. Now, he goes on to give example after example after example of contradiction. Now, food ethics and nutritional education aren't really topics I need to spend more time on right now. But the point is, when it comes to concerns about fasting, because of what we've learned about food, perhaps we need to unlearn many things that aren't good for us. That comes very naturally to us as Christians. We have to unlearn a whole lot of stuff. And as Christians, we recognize that spiritually, we have to unlearn a ton of stuff, right? We come to faith and we're like, oh man, all these beliefs I had about God were absolutely wrong. And I have to unlearn it for the rest of my life. Well, perhaps God in his wisdom, because think about what it means to be human. Being human doesn't just mean you have a spirit that goes away when you die to heaven. Being human means you are this incredible creation of body and spirit merged together. And somehow God is reflected in that. That's incredible. And so if we have to unlearn things about our spirit, perhaps we need to unlearn some things about our body as well. And so we were designed to fast. However, our flesh can fail us, and I don't want to shame those who, for medical reasons, really shouldn't fast. If that's you, eat more for the rest of us. For some, when you try to fast, you might feel sick. That could be an indication that fasting isn't for you, but it could also be an indication that you have a sugar addiction or some other kind of dietary issue that you need to rethink. And so a healthy combination of prayer and personal reflection on your own diet and perhaps consultation with a trusted doctor may be helpful for you in determining what you can and cannot do. Now, I've probably spent much too much time on the objections, but that's largely because of all the disciplines, of the 12 disciplines that we're going to be tackling over these 3 months. This is the one you want to do the least. And I already know it because you've told me for years. And because in talking to a lot of people about fasting, many haven't even ever done it, with the exception of maybe some who have a little background in Catholicism as a child. And so it's just not something that comes familiar to us. We don't want to do it. We reject it. We run away from it. And so that's why I wanted to tackle some of these objections so that you know your excuses aren't very good. And so worth noting, church historians suggest that fasting fell out of normative Christian behavior around the time of the Protestant Reformation. Now, we got a lot of things right when it came to that Reformation. But I think when it comes to fasting, maybe here's an area where we didn't get it quite right. Neither Luther nor Calvin opposed fasting, but they criticized Catholic fasts as they saw them as having aspects of legalism and works-based righteousness. Zwingli, the Swiss reformer, was a bit harsher on it, and really a lot of his teachings on it became very influential because his conviction was that if you really force somebody to fast, you're infringing on their Christian freedom. But would we say the same about prayer? Or worship, or gathering with fellow believers, or a whole host of other forms of spiritual maturity? No. Nevertheless, it's something many of us are not accustomed to doing. We don't like doing this. And so fasting is abstaining from food for spiritual purposes. So what are those spiritual purposes? Let's go ahead and look at that. As I mentioned earlier, when it comes to fasting, I see fasting, focus, and freedom all on display through the various passages here. So we're going to start off by talking about how one of the spiritual purposes of fasting is to respond to a crisis. In Esther 4, 15 through 17, we come to a true crisis. Youth recently read through Esther, so this should be familiar to them. And so what we see in Esther is that Haman was a man with authority in the Persian Empire, and he wielded that power by forcing people to bow down before him. And ultimately, Mordecai, who's described kind of like the city bum, walks by Haman. He says, nope, not bowing down. Haman gets exceptionally upset. His pride is attacked, and he said, well, genocide for the Jews. That's a pretty intense reaction. And so Esther, the wife of the king, a Jew herself, responded this way. 4:15 through 17 of Esther. Then Esther told them to reply to Mordecai, "Go, assemble all the Jews who are found in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maidens also will fast in the same way. And thus I will go into the king, which is not according to the law. And if I perish, I perish." Beautiful verse. So Mordecai went away and did just as Esther had commanded him. And so the Jewish people, facing extinction, they called a fast to focus their hearts upon the Lord, that they might be freed from the edict of Haman. Now, I can recall two times in my life that I fasted in response to a crisis. The first was when Chris and I were younger, and we had a great deal of trouble getting a marriage license. That's a complicated story for another day, but the long and the short of it is we had a very hard time getting one. And so we both, in our youth, decided to fast. I, an employee of Skyline Chili at the time, decided I'm not going to eat cheese, which is quite a challenge if you are surrounded by cheese. Kristen, the lover of chocolates and Oreos, decided I will abstain from chocolate. Now, are these complete fasts? Absolutely not. But what I did is, we used common things in our life to remind us to pray. For example, if you are surrounded by cheese all the time and you want to eat it and you're not eating it, and every time you eat it, you say, "Lord, please let me get married," that's a pretty good reminder. And so we were using that for prayer. And so the second time I fasted in response to a crisis, I'll get to later. But the point is, if a crisis has emerged in your life, fasting is a tool that God has given to us to endure through it. If it's a broken relationship, an unexpected career change, news that a loved one is ill or suffering, or perhaps there's just a huge decision that's weighing on you, the choices about a future career path or what you ought to do as a family, this is an opportunity for you to come before the Lord in fasting and prayer and say, "Lord, give me wisdom, give me peace, give me confidence in this area that I may know exactly what you would have for me here." And so secondly, we don't just fast to respond, but to prepare. And so fasting helps us to prepare for a crisis or difficulty. Ezra, for example, a priest who came after Esther, whose name literally means help, he writes about being released after the Persians conquered the Babylonians and how they tried to return to life as it was before the exile. And so as they prepared to go home, this is what Ezra writes. Ezra 8, 21 to 23. "Then I proclaimed a fast there at the river of Ahava, that we might humble ourselves before God to seek from him a safe journey for us, our little ones, and all our possessions. For I was ashamed to request from the king troops and horsemen to protect us from the enemy on the way, because we had said to the king, 'The hand of our God is favorably disposed to all those who seek him, but his power and his anger are against all those who forsake him.' So we fasted and sought our God concerning this matter, and he listened to our entreaty." I just love the honesty of this. He's like, "All right, well, we told the king that God's going to protect us, so we don't really want to ask for help. So we're just going to go ahead and fast to prepare our hearts for this treacherous journey so that we are protected along the way." And they were. And so we see that fasting becomes one of these tools that's able to prepare our hearts to endure suffering. We are not a people who really endure pain or suffering or discomfort well. And so the tools of fasting really help us do that. If you're short-tempered, anxious, prone to complaining, I assure you, fasting is the tiller that can break up the ground of your heart and prepare you to suffer well. Thirdly, fasting helps teach us what we actually need. We are a culture led to believe that it's virtuous and good to get everything we want. We're led to believe that we shouldn't be satisfied until we have just one more. We're conditioned to never be content. This phone, need a new one. This job, I'd like a new one. This car isn't fast enough, let's get the new one. Or some of us, in our honesty, we come to church and there's aspects of the church we complain about. Some of us are like, this worship band doesn't sing my favorite songs. This pastor, he just preaches too long. So we have these complaints and we say, we want a new one. We want a different one. We're conditioned to never be satisfied. And ultimately, the world banks on your dissatisfaction. Much of American culture revolves around this idea that they can convince you that you're a fool and that your life will never be complete until you get just a little bit more. What this teaches us is that we are spiritual gluttons. We are spiritual gluttons. We don't talk a lot about gluttony in the church. And I think when it comes to gluttony, the issue is less about how much we eat, but more about how much our hearts long to consume and have. We are so dissatisfied at all times, it seems, when talking to other people. I just need this. I just need that. Or maybe you need to be content with what the Lord has given you. And so we have to ask ourselves, are we spiritually gluttonous? Many are. Jesus said in John chapter 4, I have food to eat that you do not know about. So the disciples were saying to one another, no one brought him anything to eat, did he? I love it. Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. And so if you've bought into the lie that there's something in this life that can satisfy you apart from Jesus, then in response to that, gluttony, we are called to fast, to focus on God, to be freed from the propaganda, to be freed from the lie that something or someone besides God can satisfy us. And so in doing so, we'll find that we already have everything we need in God. And our fast from food will become a feast upon God and his word. This doesn't have to be a gloomy, depressing time. It can be an occasion to celebrate. And fourthly, we learn humility and our hearts are exposed. King David wrote in Psalm 69:10, when I wept in my soul with fasting, it became my reproach. Fasting humbled and convicted David. It humbles someone because fasting exposes you. I chose the garden tiller as an example or as a tool for fasting because they both have very similar functions. A tiller tears apart the soil and exposes all the weeds, all the mess that need to be torn out and thrown away. Fasting does the same thing with our hearts. It exposes all the sin in us that needs to be torn out and thrown away. Like a tiller, it can be intense and seem violent. And when fasting, I know that I've fasted. I've talked to other people who fast, and oftentimes those who do experience a shortness of patience, a shortness of all kind of things. They're more prone to anger. And so we're very tempted when fasting or from abstaining from something to point to that thing as justification for why we're cruel, right? So we may abstain from food and say I lash out at my wife while doing that. I could say, oh, sorry, dear, I was just hungry. No, I'm just wicked. I removed the food, which was the mask over my wickedness, and now my true wicked self has been exposed before her. And so that's the kind of thing that fasting does. It removes all the masks of comfort that we like to cling to, and it exposes the sinful person within us that we so often medicate with comfort. And so I just really challenge you to be ready for that. It can be a difficult thing, but it's such a good thing, because just in the same way that we would praise a doctor for cutting away at flesh and tearing into muscle and maybe getting to an organ that is infected and treating it, We praise that. So we should do the same thing when it comes to fasting. As God exposes those things within our heart, within our soul that need to be healed, we ought to rejoice over the fact that he is doing the work of a physician on our souls. And so when we fast, we're able to focus more upon God, and in doing so, God reveals to us the idols that we have been holding on to and invites us to be freed from them. This is a great thing. And so now we can turn our attention to getting started. How do we do this? You know, we've confronted some of our excuses and objections. We've looked at some of the purposes for abstaining from food. And now we conclude with the practical side of things. I was really tempted at this point to just like lean forward and say, don't eat and leave. But I didn't think that would be received well. And so a few practical tips as far as how to put this into reality. First off, just to reiterate what Jesus already said, keep it focused on the Lord. Keep it focused on the Lord. Do not call attention to what you are doing. If you know this is a temptation for you, then you probably know what you need to do here. You need to abstain from social media, abstain from opportunities where you're going to be boasting about it and telling other people. The bottom line is, in everything you're doing here, keep it as private as possible and keep it focused on a relationship with the Lord and building that up.
Secondly, schedule it. Schedule it. As I said before, you will never wake up. This is what I want to do today. I am not a prophet, but I'm confident of that. You are never going to get up and say, now is the day that I do not eat, and tomorrow is going to be like it. Never going to happen. And so you have to schedule it. And I'd suggest scheduling it a few days ahead, because then you can prepare your heart. You can prepare your mind for, like, okay, it's coming. It's coming. And you'll get ready for it. Thirdly, start small. Seek progress. Don't try to fast for 40 days starting tomorrow. You will fail. And so set realistic goals. Biblically, there are partial fasts. You may decide to only eat a certain kind of food for a time so that you can focus more on the Lord. The point here is, you know, seek out real goals that you can think you can achieve, whether it's I'm going to skip one meal for a week or more. You decide what you think you can start with. Fourthly, avoid gorging. Doing a buffet before a fast is fun. I speak from experience. Don't do it. It is suffering later. And so smaller meals will prepare your body and will make the actual physical discomfort much less intense. Similarly, if you're a coffee or caffeine addict such as myself, you either need to decide if you're going to wean yourself off of it or if you're just going to keep drinking it while you are fasting. In my case, I have enough addictions. I'm going to deal with my coffee addiction later. And so when it comes to fasting, I generally drink water, drink coffee, and conclude that I'll deal with headaches another time in my life. And so fifth, we need to set boundaries and commit to them. Set boundaries and commit to them. For instance, what are you going to allow yourself? And are you skipping one meal, two meals, a day worth of meals? Here, the cool thing here is because it's an expectation and not a commandment, you have a tremendous amount of freedom to decide how you want to be faithful and obedient in this area. I think that's a very freeing thing. I think that's a very exciting thing. And so you have the freedom to decide, okay, I want to get started in this. I'm just going to skip a breakfast and just see how it goes. Just see how it goes. Or you have the freedom to say, no, I think I can do breakfast and a lunch. See how it goes. But whatever boundaries you set for yourself, and I encourage you to be specific, honor them. For example, I mentioned earlier that I fasted in response to crisis twice. One was in prayer for a marriage license. The other actually led me here. So back in 2021, I had a lot of unrest and lack of peace as to whether or not I should still be serving at the Cincinnati Chinese Church. I let them know that. I shared that very clearly with them, and I told them, hey, when I look at crisis in the scriptures, I see that people respond with fasting, so I'm going to fast on Mondays indefinitely until I know whether or not I should be here. Just what I told them. And so I set the boundaries for that. I decided, okay, what does that mean for me? What that means is on Mondays, I won't eat until after 5. So I picked a hard time. After 5, I'm free to eat. Many Mondays, I ate very close to 5, but it was after 5. And so I gave myself those boundaries, and I committed to about 10 months of fast and prayer over that. And so after talking to the leaders there, after prayer, after fasting, after talking to leaders here, it was becoming apparent that the Lord was leading me here. And I had tremendous peace in that. And so the point is, when you to set these boundaries and bring it before the Lord and commit to it. If the Lord hadn't if the Lord hadn't given me peace after 10 months, I'd still be doing it. It's just a matter of commit to something and do it. Finally, let the hunger be a reminder. And so I find it beneficial before a fast to choose something or someone specific to pray for. For instance, I prayed for peace concerning my career, concerning ministry. I prayed for my friend who is struggling with lust. Choose ahead of time something or someone to pray for. And as often as you feel that hunger pain, let that be a reminder to pray for that particular person or situation. I find that very, very helpful. It helps focus the prayer. And as Ben mentioned last week, the prayers don't have to be exceptionally long. Just be, Lord, I lift this up. And so in conclusion, the three F's I mentioned were fasting, focus, and freedom. One F I omitted was feeling. Fasting will likely not feel very good. In fact, during the fast, there may be times when you feel very frustrated, endure, Remember that you're not seeking to learn to trust in an invisible God by you are learning to trust an invisible God by letting go of one of the most visible forms of comfort, food. The point is not to gain some spiritual high like you might experience at a retreat. Fasting will not transform you overnight into some spiritual giant. And it's not a way that you can manipulate God or get him to do something you want. It may be the case that you fast for something for years and you never get it. The point isn't that you use fasting as a way to get something from God. What was the point of fasting? To conform us to the image of his son. And so in the process of coming before the Lord and fasting, it might be the case that he never gives us the thing we ask for, but he will give us exactly what it is we need, which is to become more and more like Christ through the process of doing it. And so this process, as we have noted, can leave someone feeling very raw and exposed. One does not till a garden and then become enraged when plants don't immediately spring forth. Fasting is a tilling process. It's preparation that will allow the fruit of the Spirit to grow in you. And so when you fast, be patient with yourself as you would be patient with a garden. Seek to identify the weeds and make necessary steps to remove them. Be honest about where your garden is weak, but also don't be ashamed to celebrate when your garden is flourishing. After all, if God is doing work in you, celebrate it. And so as we go, I want to challenge you to put this into practice this week. Now, it's kind of hard to be accountable to something done in secret, but I hope that you will do it. And so you have the freedom to set the boundaries, whether it's one meal or even just a specific food. Consider a person or an issue in your heart that you'd like more focus on and to bring before the Lord in prayer. And so as you do so, know that ultimately the reward will come from him who sees what you've done in secret. So with that, let's go ahead and pray and we'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this time together. Lord, I pray for the strength of the Holy Spirit to put into practice the things that we see in your word. Lord, to pray without ceasing, to come before you and be faithful in fasting, to think through what it means to faithfully follow you every single day, whether it's here, whether it's in the monotonous aspects of our lives at work or anywhere else. Lord, help us to be faithful in every little part of our lives, whether that part is exciting or mundane. Lord, we love you so much. And as we go forth from here, let us reflect your goodness out into the world. It's in your son's holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Well, I-